Good morning. Today we will be having a discussion on a ward round scenario and an operative surgery. Today will be Professor Shomita Chatterjee, who is Professor of Surgery at IPGM Hospital, Kolkata. And the presenter will be Dr. R.M. Jyoti from MR Bangur Hospital. So, Jyoti, share the summary of the patient.
Sir, is it visible, sir?
Yeah, it's visible.
Yes, it's visible.
Good morning, everyone. Today, 40 years lady underwent cholecystectomy and cholecystectomy and closure of cholecystectomy over a T2. Today is postoperative day 1 and T2 drainage in bag is 450 ml. How will you proceed to manage this patient?
Okay, Jyoti. So as sir said that you come for your rounds in the morning and this is what you see. You just see the bag. So what are you going to do about the patient?
And first, initially, I'll ask the patient if any patient is having any complaints, like any pain.
Okay. So patient says that she is just having pain at the surgical site. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, she doesn't have any problem at the moment.
And she's having like nausea, vomiting. I'll ask for existing symptoms.
No, she does not have any nausea, vomiting. She's just complaining of pain.
Okay. And I'll examine the patient. Patient is having any, because patient is on post-operative day 1 and patient is NPM. So I'll see for any signs of dehydration and I'll check vitals.
So what are the signs of dehydration that you will check for clinically?
Any tongue is dry and sunken eyes and skin turgor.
Okay. So mind you, shrunken eyes, pink turgor, they take time to demonstrate. So post-op day 1 means hopefully she had been well hydrated intraoperatively and post-operatively. So you will unexpected to see shrunken eyes and loss of skin turgor immediately on post-op day 1. So but dry, yes, dry tongue is what you are going to look at. Okay. What else are you going to see?
Pulsed blood pressure.
Okay, so I tell you that the pulse is around 100 and the blood pressure is 110 by 70.
I think it is as normal, ma'am. Yeah. Abdomen having any distension or any pain, or I'll check her any drain is given, like abdominal drain.
Her abdomen is otherwise soft, but she's complaining of tenderness when you examine over the surgical site.
And I'll check her check out input-output chart, ma'am.
Okay. So post-operatively, she finished her surgery at around, say, 2:33. Since post-op 3 o'clock to today morning, she's received around 2 liters of fluid. And her urine output has been around 300 ml.
And 300 ml. Check her any drain output, right? If any T-tube output, everything I'll consider.
The T-tube, as has been mentioned, is around 450 ml. Drain output is 50 cc. Serum separation is there. Serosanguinous drain output.
It's 700 ml and input is 2 liters. Mm-hmm. Patient is a little bit less urine output.
Yes. So what would you proceed? These are your clinical and chart assessments. So what would you like to do now?
And the patient is running normally with except the decreased urine output and T-tube drainage is 450 ml. Mm-hmm.
So you have to plan her second day's input-output charting, isn't it? So what would your plan be?
Total output is 700. Around and a daily requirement of the patient, and I will add both and I will try to give that much
today. We had extensive discussion on input fluid instructions, post-operative instructions in the last class. Yes, if you remember what sir and the other teachers had said, that you have to see the output, but what you have to remember in this, whether you have to add certain insensible losses. Like if the patient is running temperature, if what is the weather like. So around 500 ml of insensible loss has to be added to your charting. Moreover, in addition to the maintenance fluid for post-op day one, you have to add this 450 ml of bile that is coming out. So what is the main composition of the bile that is coming out as far as electrolytes are concerned?
Sodium and bicarbonate.
Sodium and bicarbonate. So in addition to the calculated fluid, we'll not go into the details of that. You had an extensive class last time. You have to add this 450 ml in the form of a normal saline because to replace the sodium that is being lost along with it. So, okay. So other than looking at the input output, what else are you going to do? How are you going to manage this patient as far as the T-tube bag is concerned?
I will see the T-tube color of the color of the content also.
Yeah, so what do you expect? It's fine, isn't it? Do you really expect anything else? No. But yes, there are certain situations you might find it a little different. So what are those situations?
It is turbid like that thing due to dissection during the...
Pardon?
And turbid like...
Turbid. What do you understand when you're saying turbid? What are you thinking about?
Usually the bile is clear if it is due to turbid during the dissection time.
So if you've had a long-term stagnant situation, then only you might have some turbid bile. Otherwise, either this is a colitopolithotomy. So you are not really expecting much of turbid bile. But there may be something else in addition to bile which might alter the color of the bile. What could that be? Though not commonly, we sometimes find some amount of blood along with the bile. If you've had a difficult dissection, if you've had an impacted stone which you had to struggle to bring out, there may be some amount of oozing within the CBD. So in that case, your bile may be mixed with some amount of blood. But in most cases, what we find is pure bile which comes through the T-tube, right?
Actually,
yes.
Madam has asked me a general question. How will you proceed?
Yes.
And idea of examining a patient on the first post-op day is number one to see whether the patient is having a normal road to recovery or she is having some complications. So to find out that, don't stop at pain abdomen and nausea vomiting. This patient having a major surgery may develop chest complication within the first 24 hours. She may have a deep vein thrombosis, and you have to address these complications, whether this is happening in the first post-op day. So the last day we discussed the approach for such patients. I'll take a good history of the patient about any complaint. I'll do examination of the patient and I'll review the chart. In the chart, you'll get the patient vital over the period which she is passing following the operation. You are looking at the morning. So this should be the answer. I'll take a good history to assess whether she is progressing well or she is having some complications. And then I'll examine the patient. You take the vitals and then examine the abdomen and other chest and lower limbs. And then review the chart. Chart shows she has got urine of 300 ml. So to plan the fluid in this patient, you have to address this oliguria. And madam has said that patient has got a pulse of 100. But
yes.
Which I feel is tachycardic. She has
exactly.
110 by 70. It is towards the lower side. So might be that the input you have given 2 liters was not adequate. So before you chart for next 24 hours fluid, you have to address this oliguria and see whether this is because of less volume being given. Okay, so that should be the approach. Now come to the T-tube. Yes.
See, the main thing is a tachycardia is often the first symptom, first thing manifestation of an underhydration. Right. So even before you manifest a hypotension or anything, the tachycardia is the first thing. So the intent of giving you a borderline raised pulse rate was this, that you have to give her some fluid challenge because there is a tachycardia and a low urine output. And if you see that it is improving after that, that's fine. Okay. Otherwise, you have to look for other causes of tachycardia. Yeah, please continue. How will you manage to proceed this now? You've made your charts. You've clinically assessed the patient. You've reviewed the chart. You've planned your input-output following the next day. What would be a good antibiotic in this case where you have explored the common bile duct?
The biliary system contains the enterobacteria. So third generation cephalosporins I will try.
Okay. And particularly if you have a system which is a stagnated system, Like in this case, any cases of obstructive jaundice, be it due to stone or other system, there is a high possibility of high amounts of bacteremia. You have to remember that bacteria are normally present in everybody's bile, including yours and mine, but they are usually not symptomatic. But in a stagnant system, the bacterial count rises, and this is a very potent source of infection, even in otherwise asymptomatic patients who are preoperatively asymptomatic, but postoperatively they might go into a high count might raise, and there may be signs of sepsis. So your antibiotic coverage should not be empirical. It should be something which is excreted well in bile. And as you said, a third generation cephalosporin, a good option will be a cefepime-sulbactam combination, which is highly secreted in bile, is a good option for a stagnated biliary system surgery. Yes, said something? Yeah, continue, Jyoti.
As the patient is in little, in the second post-op, I will continue to correct the dehydration and continue the antibiotic and pain management.
Yes.
If the patient is progressing normally, daily I will assess the patient's output, input output, and the drain output. Mm-hmm. If the patient is progressing normally till POD 7, then yes. On POD 8, I want to do T2 cholangiogram 1 to know that.
Okay, I'll just stop you at the while. You said progressing well. So is it you're still keeping the patient on IV fluid, or are you going to give her? Yes.
Orally.
Yes. So if the abdomen is settled and you see that the IPS is there, patient's input output is being well maintained, patient is looking improved in status, you have to start giving her challenges of oral liquids first and escalate it as per tolerance by the patient. Right? Okay. So what about the T-tube? You said that the first day it was 450, but next subsequently it became around 600. 600. And then it was continuing around that time. So what are you going to look for? What are you going to anticipate about the amount of bile that is being drained in the T-tube in a normal recovery?
Usually around 300 ml, I will think now. If it is more than 300, there is a lot. Bile is rich in the sodium and bicarbonate. I will see the signs of any hyponatremia are there. And yes. Patient is blood test, any arthritic changes are there. Like,
see, why do you expect this increase in amount? You said first day it was 450, but I said the second, third, fourth day, it was increasing. Okay, so why this increase in amount?
Can you tell us the chronology? If you put a T-tube and you follow the patient in the ward for next 7 days, what do you expect on first post-op day, then second, third, fourth, fifth, seventh, eighth? How does this drainage goes? What is the usual pattern?
Yes.
Sorry,
are you happy on first postum day with 450 ml of bile drain, or you are concerned that something is wrong? You should be happy.
450 seems okay.
It is around 300 to 500 ml. Okay, I'm not concerned. I am happy that yes, she is drained. But if you find in the morning of first postum day, find there is only 20 ml of bile, and patient has a pain in the abdomen which is not coinciding with the usual post-op pain. Only 25 ml of bile in the drain bag.
If you have a very low bile intake, like sir is saying, what will be your concern?
Madam, I will see whether the bile is coming inside any drain. Otherwise, I think abdomen. It is going freely into the...
So what are the two things? It could be either that there is a diminished flow of bile, or there is a block in the T-tube, or there is a bile leak. So you may have a low T-tube output, but an increased bile output in the abdominal drain. So a few things you have to keep in mind. Even if a T-tube gets blocked, it might leak through the cholecystectomy incision into the abdomen and be drained in the abdominal drain. Right. So if you have a low output also in the T-tube in the first day, that is a cause of concern. But this 450 seems to be a favorable. Yes, sir?
Sir, your audio is not working. In rare instances, you can find that the T-tube is dislodged from the cholecystectomy.
Yes, that is rare.
So you should keep in mind that this amount of low means you have to address the issue. You should try to find out why it is happening. And if you see this patient has got such situation, no bile is coming and patient is giving severe pain abdomen. Generalized pain abdomen, patient is crying, not doing analgesics, what might have gone wrong?
The bile is draining into the abdomen, so patient developed peritonitis.
Yes,
yes, it could be biliary peritonitis.
That means the tissue might have been dislodged and patient has got signs of biliary peritonitis.
So this is a scenario where your count will go up also. So when you monitor the post-op count after 24 hours, this is something you have to keep in mind as well. Subsequently, next few days, what are you expecting? Normal chronology?
And if patient T2B is kept for to maintain the patency of the
what is the chronology of drainage? How much you expect in the second, third, fourth, fifth, seventh day? Is it same or more or little less?
So it will be decreasing in condition as the patency of the maintain if there is no distal obstruction.
Now, what if you find that suddenly the amount is going up? You were getting 450, now it has gone up to 600, 700 post op day 2 and 3. What will you think?
I will think of any distal obstruction like in the biliary system.
Okay, so what could be the causes of distal obstruction?
Maybe residual stones, maybe.
But residual stone, you really don't have much to do. But if you're following up and you see gradually that over the next 2-3 days, again, the volume is going down. So what could have been the cause of these intermittent rise in the
early
post-op period? It could be edema.
Irritation.
It could be edema of the sphincter of OD. So if there is edema of the sphincter of OD, the distal flow of bile is less. So most of it is going to come out through the T2. So that can cause a transient increase in the flow of bile through the T2. But as the edema subsides over the next few days, the distal flow starts beginning and the T2 drainage might again come down to normal as well as lower than normal. Okay? Okay, so what would you do next?
I will assess the patient daily. Mm-hmm. POD7, it is going normally. Mm-hmm. I will plan for T-tube cholangiogram on the POD 8 to 10 today.
Other than only assessing the amount of bile coming through the T-tube, what else about the T-tube are you going to assess on your daily rounds?
Maintain the position of the T-tube.
Yes, it should be dependent. Because remember, there is no suction or anything. It is a dependent drainage. It's a gravity-assisted drainage. So the position of the T-tube bag should be possible. And a peri-T-tube leakage or not is there, that also has to be noticed. Because remember, bile is a bad exfoliant. So you might have excoriation in the peri-T-tube region. And a peri-T-tube leakage also means that there is some amount of pericholidocotomy leakage. Everything is not coming out through the T-tube. So care of the T-tube, including its position and the exit site of the T-tube from the abdominal wall, that care also has to be given. Okay? Okay, please continue.
Why do you wait till 8th or 10th day to have a cholangiogram being done? Why not 48 hours?
Sir, to form the proper track, it will take...
The track actually takes longer. Sorry, sir.
Initially, immature tunnel forms around the T-tube. You wait for that.
See, initially, before we used to use the red rubber T-tubes, right? They were highly reactive irritants. So the tract used to form earlier. Now the PVC tubes that we use, the PVC tubes are less irritant. So it actually takes a little longer for the mature tract to form. So also at the same time, before doing the T-tube cholangiogram, we would want the patient's abdomen to settle down. So by 7-8 days, the patient's abdomen is settled. Usually he is tolerating a diet and the patient is comfortable. So we immediately post of 48 hours, we usually do not go for a T-tube cholangiogram. Okay? Right. So how do you proceed with a T-tube cholangiogram? What are the steps of a T-tube cholangiogram? What precaution as a surgical resident would you have to take?
Madam, I'll ask the patient to keep NPM on the day of the T-tube cholangiogram, and I'll clamp the T-tube on the day of cholangiogram. And after assessing the patient, I'll inject the urographin dye, 60% urographin into.
Before injecting the dye, would you have to do anything?
I will assess the test, sensitivity test.
Okay, that is one thing. But anything else?
Clamping the T-tube.
suppose you directly inject the urographin into the T-tube. What might inadvertently...
Flushing has to be done too.
Exactly. Because if there is air in the tube and you directly inject the urographin, that air bubble may be pushed into the CBD and that will give you a false negative image, a false impression in your T-tube plates. So you have to initially flush it and only after that you introduce urographin. What percentage urographin do you use and how much urographin do you use?
60% urographin.
Yes, and how much?
So it will be around 20 ml in divided doses. So first we will give 2 to 3 ml.
Yes.
And later I'll take the control picture, control image. And mm-hmm. later I will introduce 5 total around 20 ml.
Okay. And what about not so much? You don't require so much.
Get less volume because you need more volume. The small stone may be missed because of the dye all around the stone. So you get about 2 to 3 ml in the first go and see under fluoroscopy. And then to reassess, to feel the upper ducts, might inject more and then change the position if you are concerned about the lower end of the bile duct. So 20 ml is not required for a T-tube cholangiogram. Maybe
so usually 3 to 4 ml is good enough. If you are not happy, then only you introduce more, not right at the moment. 20 ml will have also a dilutional effect and you will miss the small stones which may be present. Okay?
Okay.
So when you are about to assess the higher ducts, the upper ducts, then you will give a head low position. Yes, you will give a head low position so that the dye flows upwards and gives you a better visualization. Subsequently, you will give a head up position so that the dye flows downwards and you get a better visualization of the lower end of the CBD. So when you do a T-tube cholangiogram, what are the things that you assess in the plate? You have a T-tube cholangiogram plate. What are the things that you are going to assess?
Madam, entire biliary system will assess whether is there any patent is there or any block is there or any leak is there. I'll ask.
Okay. What else? Jyoti, can't hear you.
Madam, I will assess the entire biliary whether any block is there, any leak in distal patent, entire biliary system is patency, I will check.
So you are going to look for the anatomy of the biliary tree first. Number one, okay, to see, so if there is any leakage, pericholitopal leakage, if there is a good distal outflow, meaning it is passing into the duodenum, and definitely any filling defects within the CBD, right? So if you find any filling defects within the CBD, what are your thoughts going to be?
I'll assess whether filling defects are there, means it may be due to residual stones. Are any due to artifact like air bubbles are there? So I will.
So how will you identify one from the other?
And if air bubble is there, it is darkly black. And if changing the position, it will alter the air bubble position. But CBD is too. I mean, if I'm suspecting.
So also, it is uniform. Okay. Right. If you have a circular uniform shape, negative shadow, that means it could be an air bubble. So it is dark in color. Uniform in shape and changes position with change of position of the patient. What about the stone?
It's not regular round shape, it is irregular and it is not darkly and it will not change position.
It may not change position. Okay. So now you have got this plate. The patient has come back to the ward. You've evaluated the plate and you see, like we very commonly see, that there is a small filling defect in the lower end, about 1.5 millimeter, which appears to be irregular. And the technician has commented that there was no change of position with change of position of the patient. Now, what is your next step going to be?
Well, I think it is as a residual stone. And
okay.
And the size is of 1.5.
1 to 1.5, yeah.
1 to 1.5. And I'll see whether there is free, even the stone is there, whether there is any free flow of contrast with the duodenum or not,
There is some free flow of contrast into the duodenum. So it is not blocking the outlet totally. if it was blocking the outlet totally, what would have been the clinical manifestation of the patient?
My patient is having obstructive symptoms, like cold.
But what is the first symptom that she is going to manifest?
Pain
is going to be the first thing. So don't expect jaundice immediately after that. That may be a delayed presentation. The main thing is pain. There'll be nausea. There may be vomiting tendency. So the pain is the predominant feature in such a case. Okay. So here in our patient, there is no total obstruction. You can see some dye flowing into the duodenum, but you can appreciate a filling defect in the lower end of the CBD. What? How are you going to tackle this?
There are various methods to
what would you do in your ward if tomorrow you have such a patient?
There is free flow, so I will wait for I'll keep the T-tube in situ mark. And I will wait to form mature tract.
So it will take some time to form the mature tract. Are you not going to do anything in between? Is there any pharmacological intervention that you might be thinking of?
Madam, so to relax the sphincter of OT, I'll try to give the hyoscine to relax the sphincter. So maybe it can really...
You expect the stone, if it's a small stone, to pass out with a relaxed sphincter of OT, right?
Yes.
So if it is not passing out and the situation is persisting, is there anything else that you can do? You have relaxed the sphincter of OD, but is there some way of flushing the system that you can think of in case of small stones? Obviously, a large stone, it will not work, but in small stones?
Mechanical irrigation with the...
Okay, mechanical irrigation. So how do you do mechanical irrigation?
With a heparinized solution to I'll mix.
How much heparin? How much normal saline?
And 250 ml of normal saline with the...
With?
25,000 international units of heparin.
25,000 units of heparin. And how do you do it? What is the method of doing it?
I will inject 250 ml with heparinized solution. I will inject daily for 3 days, man, and I will assess.
Inject where?
Into
the T-tube. So introduce into, when you say inject, we usually think it's into the system. So you will introduce it into the T-tube for how many days?
For 3 days, 3 to 5 days.
3 to 5 days. Okay. And after the 3 to 5 days, what do you do?
Repeat
colangiogram. You can repeat a colangiogram to see whether the distal stone has been washed off. Okay. Fair enough. Now, suppose you see that after the 3 to 5 days, you go back and do your T-tube colangiogram again, and you see that the stone is lying where it was. Nothing, there has been no improvement. What can be your next step of action?
It indicates that... stone is a bigger one and it's not moving with the mechanical irrigation also.
Okay. So what else can you do? What will be your next step of action? Stone has not moved out. Now you're into day 12 or 13. 7th or 8th day you had done the T-tube colangiogram. Then 3 days you had done the irrigation. 9th and 11th you've repeated it. Day 12, you did the repeat colangiogram. Today is day 13. So what do you do now?
Madam, ERCP with the spin.
You want to do an ERCP. Okay, why do you want to do an ERCP?
As the edema, as the days, it's been 1 week and edema also subsided. So, and stone is also not larger stone.
So you can do an ERCP. What else do you have to do? ERCP with?
Spin
complete the... enterotomy? Not enterotomy. What do you think? Sphincterotomy. Okay. Yes. Yes. So you can do an ERCP. You can do a sphincterotomy and then the stone may be taken out with a Dornier basket. What happens to the T-tube? The T-tube is still there in situ. Can you do an ERCP while the T-tube is in situ? You have to take out the T-tube before you do the ERCP, because otherwise you cannot introduce the Dornier basket to take out the stone. So in the same sitting at the ERCP area, the T-tube is taken out, the ERCP is introduced and the stone may be taken out using a Dornier basket.
Then you have to stent.
Pardon, sir?
You have to stent.
Yes.
Because you have a rent in the bile duct.
Yes. Subsequently, you are going to put a stent. Because otherwise, you're going to have leakage of bile through the colitopotum. Okay. After how many months will you take off the stent that you have introduced? After how long will you take out the stent?
No.
Usually, it is sometime after 6 to 8 weeks. Sometimes after 6 to 8 weeks, you can take out the stone, take out the stent, because by that time, we expect the colitopotomy to have healed. Okay. Now, suppose you have misassessed the T-tube cholangiogram report and you have taken out the T-tube. And subsequently, you see that the patient is developing icterus. Patient is complaining of pain abdomen. Subsequently, patient developed icterus. And you have done a repeat USG to see what is the problem. And they say there are two findings. Number one, there is a collection in the peritocal region, that is a biloma there. And also, there could be a filling defect in the lower end. So your T-tube is out. So what can you do?
Madam, I will ask the ultrasound whether how is the bile system, whether it is dilated or not, or still it's like the, in undilated state.
Okay, it is slightly dilated, about 1 centimeter in around 0.9 to 1 centimeter in diameter.
And there is residual stone is there, and some little bit bile collection is there, mm-hmm. and patient is jaundiced. Mm-hmm. So I think that still residual stone is there. Mm-hmm. And it is, and so
you have two issues in hand. Number one, there is a biloma, and number two, you have a residual stone. So now, how are you going to proceed? There are two aspects that you have to keep in mind.
Madam, how many days?
He is about now. You've taken out the tube around 14 days, and subsequently, the patient was sent home. He's come back to your OPD after a week with icterus and pain abdomen. And you have readmitted the patient for the necessary investigations. So maybe 3 weeks down the line.
How do you address the collection? How do you address the residual stone?
Yeah, so there are two issues, I said, right?
If the bilioma is organized and it is localized, I'll try to do the percutaneous drainage.
So it is an image-guided drainage. It may be a one-time drainage if it is a small localized collection. Or you might have to leave a pigtail catheter in situ if you see that after the drainage, you know, that patient is recollecting it. So as long as you don't address the distal obstruction, the patient might continue to recollect there. The biloma might reform. So you have to do both things. Number one, an image-guided aspiration stroke pigtail drainage of the biloma. And number two will be addressing the residual stone, which can be addressed, like you said previously, with an ERCP and Romia basket clearance with a stent in situ. Okay? Okay. Now, your patient, this is a different patient who's had a clean T-tube cholangiogram and you plan to take out the T-tube. So, how do you proceed to take out the T-tube?
There is normal patency is there. So, I'll clamp the T-tube overnight. And I'll ask next day, I'll ask the patient is having any pain abdomen, any distension. If nothing is there, I'll take out the T-tube on the next day morning.
How do you take it out?
Just a pull, it will come out, man, because we made a slit in the shoe.
So it is you just got to use two words. It's called a sharp, smart pull. So it has to be, cannot be a hesitant pull, because if you have a hesitant pull, the colitopotomy, which was there, it might get extended. So it has got to be a sharp, smart pull. A sharp, smart pull, and you take the T-tube out. Okay. What are the things that you observe for subsequent to removal? Do you immediately send the patient home or next day?
Next day, ma'am. Because
next day. What do you observe over this period? One day?
There may be a little bit of bile leak, ma'am, as we got the T-tube from the biliary system. So yes. I'll assess the patient. Patient is having any pain abdomen or any little bit of collection. I mean, patient is...
You will advise, also inform the patient that for a day or two, there may be some collection, some discharge from the T-tube side. This is because the colitopotomy will continue to discharge a little bit of bile and colitopotomy will continue to discharge a little bit of bile and the tube collapses between 24 to 48 hours. So once the tract, I mean, so once the tract collapses, then the discharge from the site decreases totally. So it may take 24 to 48 hours during that period, there may be some discharge from the T-tube site. Okay?
See, if you just go back to the operation table now, little back, you have done a colorectal lithotomy, and now you have a rent in the bile duct. What was done in this patient is surgeon has put a T-tube.
See?
What can be the other? Surgeon has put a T-tube and closed the colorectomy. What can be the other option? When you have done a colorectal lithotomy, apart from putting a T-tube, what can be the other options on table?
Okay.
Sir, patient, if a colonoscopy done, if setup is having a colonoscope, we can pass this colonoscope and remove the stone. So it is a direct measure in the entire bile system is patent. So we can do the primary repair of the.
So another option is primary
repair. Primary repair.
What
third option?
That you have correctly said that you should ensure that you have done a complete clearance. That can be done either by colonoscope or by.
Intraoperative
colangio. Fine.
Intraoperative
colangio. One option is primary closure. What is the other option? Patient
sir,
has multiple stones, sign the bile that is grossly dilated.
If bile system is dilated, we can do biliary entric anastomosis.
Like biliary entric anastomosis. So what are the options of a biliary entric anastomosis?
One by the colidocoduodenostomy or ruined by hepaticogeuodenostomy.
Not hepatico, colidoco.
So you have done a colidocotomy. The options are these. One is you can close it over a T-tube. You can do a primary closure. And you can do a biliary entric anastomosis. More and more people are now preferring to have primary closure. What is the advantage of primary closure about putting a T-tube? How primary closure is scoring better and people are more adapting to this technique?
Advantage of primary closure over a T-tube. See, the hospital stay will automatically decrease because with a T-tube, the patient would have stayed for another 2 weeks till the T-tube cholangiogram and everything was done. So the hospital stay is decreased. The patient is more comfortable. But the point to be remembered is that you have to be absolutely sure that you've achieved a total
clearance.
Yes. Because there is no way of assessing it other than a USG, which is again a very much a man-dependent investigation to know whether you have left anything behind or not. The T-tube cholangiogram is a very good system because it leaves an avenue for investigating and evaluating the CBD ulcer. So in a primary closure, we do not have that advantage. So you have to be very sure that you've achieved total clearance when you're planning to do primary closure. Another thing is, sir.
In one line, it will be you avoid the morbidity related to the T-tube. You avoid morbidity related to the T-tube. Patient is in the bed, patient is in the extra tube. You need to do a T-tube cholangiogram in the post-op period. And that is all the complications related to the T-tube dislodgement. And if you do a primary closure, you have to have a very good radiology backup. This patient might leak to some extent. And there might be some pericolonical collection. If it is there, you have to drain under image guidance.
Right.
Okay. Okay, you have discharged the patient. That patient come back to you after 6 months with classic feature of acute cholangitis. What will you do? Patient came back to you after 6 months. With classic features of acute cholangitis.
Sir, usually I'll think patient is having maybe biliary stricture may form. Patient is having.
How are you going to evaluate the patient?
And first I will do the basic investigation ultrasound abdomen.
Even before that, clinically assess.
Clinically assess.
Yes, clinically assess the patient.
Patient is having any pain, fever, and how many episodes of.
So there is going to be history of pain, history of fever. There may be icterus, yes. And sometimes you may also feel a lump in the abdomen. Okay, depending on what is causing the cholangitis. Okay. So once you've examined her clinically, what is the investigation? What are the investigations that you're going to proceed with?
I'll go with the first basic ultrasound whole abdomen part to see if any collection is there and see any residue stones are there. I mean, and direct any biliary system dilatation is there like
okay. Will you not do an LFT? Will you not do a count? Because see, these are also part of the basic investigation. Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So you have to do a count to see there is a race count, because if you're thinking in terms of cholangitis, the counts are going to be raised. Secondly, your LFT, if it is raised, you will know for sure that whether it is a conjugated hyperbilirubinemia or is there any other cause of jaundice. You can have other causes of jaundice only. Just because it is a post-op patient does not necessarily mean that the jaundice is because of the surgery. So you have to rule out other causes of jaundice as well. So you're going to do a count, you're going to do an LFT. As you correctly said, you're going to do a USG to see whether there is any collection, what is the status of the biliary tree, and and whether there's any other associated finding. Now, is USG the best option to assess the anatomy of the biliary tree, or would you like to do anything else?
MRCPI is a...
Yes. So you would like to, because you were thinking along terms of a stricture. So a biliary stricture may not be picked up by USG. So you would advise an MRCPI.
Even a stone may be missed. Even a stone may be missed in the retroperitoneal part.
Right.
So it should be better that you do USG and then complement this by doing a MRCP. One should not go for diagnostic ERCP. You see, at the moment, there is no role for diagnostic ERCP.
Correct.
ERCP is done on the basis of therapeutic.
Therapeutic.
Okay.
So you've done the MRCP, and the MRCP says that there is a no distal obstruction, but there seems to be a narrowing in the mid CBD, in the area where your T tube was. So what are you going to do next?
ERCP dilatation.
You might want to do an ERCP and dilatation.
Dilatation and keeping this, if possible, strict.
Madam.
Hello.
Hello.
Sir.
Madam, you're not audible, na?
No, sir.
Okay. So you have done a MRCP that showed there is some narrowing in the area. So you said you'll do a ERCP and stenting. Okay. So how long you'll keep the stent? What will be the duration you keep the stent and then review the patient? How long you're going to keep the stent? How long?
Sir, you are not audible.
What is happening? How long will keep the stent and review the patient? What is the optimal time for keeping the stent?
Sir, 4 to 6 weeks.
Four weeks is quite early. It should be 6 to 8 weeks. So 6 to 8 weeks is the time you keep the stent and then remove the stent, do a repeat cholangiogram. And you find the stricture is not there, it is taken care of. But if there is a persistent stricture and this patient comes with recurrent cholangitis, that is a situation you should consider for doing biliary bypass. Okay. So have you heard of a term called Barin technique for tackling CBD stone? What is that? Barin technique?
Sir, we'll hit the T-tube like that only to form the metro track for 4 to 6 weeks.
Yeah.
So through that one, after metro track has formed, so we will try to remove the residual stones by...
This was the technique used earlier. Nowadays, people are not doing this, but some old examiner might ask what is Barin technique. So this is basically extraction of the residual stone by using the mature T-tube tract. So discharge the patient home with the T-tube on and then come back after 4 to 6 weeks. You take the T-tube cholangiogram, see the biliary tree, and then remove the T-tube. And by using this T-tube mature tract, you can pass a Dormia basket catheter under fluoroscopic guidance and remove the stone. Alternatively, you can use a colonoscope also. Okay. So these are the usual technique for removal of residual stone. Suppose
I think, sir, with the advent of ERCP, this has now gone into this is more of a historical importance than being practically done.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. Don't say this in the first go. I'll go for marine technique.
Yeah, I think the best option will be a evaluation, imaging evaluation, and then follow up with an ERCP to remove the residual stone.
Okay. We finish up with this T-tube. We'll have operative scenario. Dr. Acharji, Dr. Maiti, any comment? Dr. Acharji, any comment regarding T-tube discussion?
Thank you, Professor Saha. Dr. Maiti speaking. It was a very good discussion. Always it is very nice to hear Somita. He is asking question and answer and helping the students in a very nice way. And some comments I like to make. When the student is examining in the postoperative round, he or she should also look at the Ryle's tube if it is in situ. Because seeing the bile in the Ryle's tube gives also some satisfaction, and that gives the hope that in the next day, expected that the bile coming through the T-tube may be less and less. So that indicates the lower end is sufficient enough, is good, nicely functioning, and bile is entering into the duodenum. And another comment I like to also make, that before removing the T-tube and before going for the T-tube cholangiography, the simple clinical test, the clamping the T-tube, that should also be undertaken, that on few hours clamping or a day long clamping, suppose on the ninth day you can keep the T-tube clamping for the 24 hours, and if there is no pain and if the stool color is yellow, and those simple things, the simple clinical signs should also get some importance in understanding that flow of bile into the duodenum. And another thing, probably there may be some argument. If in the T-tube cholangiogram, if you find a very small stone, for example, 1 millimeter or 2 millimeter in the lower end of the CBD, instead, and if you can monitor the patient perfectly, and that there is no jaundice, there is no depression in the liver function, only the antispasmodic drug can help for some days, and there is chance of spontaneous passage of that small stone if it is very, very small, instead of going for early ERCP. That is the comment I like to make. And another comment I like to make, every patient with T-tube cholangiogram or simple cholecystectomy should get the antispasmodic drug in the postoperative period, because that antispasmodic drug is very useful to relieve the spasm of the sphincter of body. The sphincter of body may do something to prevent the free passage of bile into the duodenum. Thank you very much for it. A very wonderful class.
Dr. Maiti, I agree with the second part of your comment, that there are reports of spontaneous expulsion of stone which are very small, maybe less than 5 millimeter. That is one. Second is regarding the clamping. Nowadays, there is some inhibition about clamping of the T-tube, because clamping is allowed only when you have done a post-exploratory on-table cholangiogram. That means you have put a T-tube and you have done a on-table post-exploratory cholangiogram. You have excluded that there is no obstruction. In that case, you can do a clamping. Otherwise, clamping is not allowed, because when you are doing a clinical clamping, and suppose patient has got a residual stone, which you are not sure about it, this patient will have pain and there will be peritubal leak. So the point now is, don't clamp that T-tube till you have done a cholangiogram on the 8th post-op day. Because basic thing is to exclude a distal obstruction. If that has not been done on table, you wait till the cholangiogram is done. So this is an optional situation, that you start clamping and assess whether the patient has pain or patient has stool color is returning. So this now is not being favored.
Professor Saha, on this point, I want to ask the your experience. You, Dr. Somita, Dr. Acharya, Bosa, what you actually do in the wards?
We don't clamp. Instead of doing clamping
for 24 hours, sometimes we do a periodic clamping. For example, 8 hours, 10 hours. So even if when the patient will get the pain, then we can relieve the clamp. That will cause no harm to the patient.
Before pain, there may be peritubal leak if there is obstruction. So nowadays, we don't practice this clamping till you are done a cholangiogram and excluded there is no distal obstruction. So that is an option. Yes, I agree. But more and more people are not relying on clamping as a test for distal patency.
It cause too much harm to the patient because
yeah, that's true. I agree.
Already the tract is formed, and already there is, if you can relieve the clamp whenever the patient gets the even simple small amount of pain, you can relieve the clamp.
Okay.
Keep it for a long time.
Okay. Dr. Acharji, any comment?
Just two comments. In the management of the mid-CVD stricture following T-tube, after 6 months of withdrawal of the T-tube, the student has directly said that the first attempt should be balloon dilatation and stenting. The stenting, regarding stenting, I will stress the point that if possible, the largest stone, largest size stain, like a 10-French stain, and if possible, two stents, either 10-French or 1 10-French, 1 7-French, should be put in. That will act as a dilator.
Yes.
That is one thing. And secondly, regarding clamping, the student said the overnight clamping. I'll ask her neighbor to do that, because in case the patient has any problem at night, it will be difficult to get a RMO. They are not always available. The bed in charge, he's also not always available at night, at dead of night. And the doctors are not at the best of their efficiency at night. So always, if you were to clamp it, always do it in the morning and watch the patient for the rest of the day.
Yeah. Okay,
accepted.
Okay, I think Dr. Shomita, you can go to the operative scenario.
I think we have two operative scenarios.
He starts with the lab colostomy first. Okay. If time permits, we'll go on.
Yeah. Yes, Jyoti.
Yes, ma'am. Today I'm going to discuss about the laparoscopic cholecystectomy.
Yes.
Location of the ulcer, whether it is in the foot, if it is foot, it is in the dorsum of the foot or the plantar aspect of the foot.
What is this?
No, something else is going on.
Oh, okay.
So meet karo, Alok. Meet kar de yaar, kisko? Somebody else is talking.
Okay. Yes, Jyoti, you can start.
After getting the fitness for the surgery, patient is under supine position with under general anesthesia with endotracheal tube and in situ. Patient is supine. After proper dressing and draping, first thing is the creation of the pneumoperitoneum. We will give a 1 cm incision supraumbilically, dissect the tissues, and I will do the close technique, ma'am, with the varis technique. I'll lift up the abdominal wall and put the varis needle into the triangle direction into the lower abdomen. So after entering into the abdominal, I'll attach the carbon dioxide and at a flow rate of 1 to 2 liters per minute initially.
Jyoti, I'll stop you for a moment.
Okay.
You said that you've introduced the varis needle into the abdomen after lifting the abdominal wall. How do you know that your varis needle is in the correct position?
Ma'am, as varis needle acts like a spring, as a spring action. So when we enter into the peritoneum, there's a sudden loss of resistance and popping sound will come. And we can check with saline irrigation also.
Saline irrigation, or is it something else? Yes, we use saline, but what is it? It's not irrigation.
Saline.
See, there are 3 or 4 methods of knowing that your varis needle is in the right place. Number one, when you're introducing it, as you correctly said, it's a spring action. You get a sensation of loss of resistance when you enter the peritoneal cavity. So they say there are 2 clicks. Once you negotiate the linea alba, and then once you negotiate the peritoneum, there are 2 clicks that you feel once your varis needle is inside. Once inside, the next step is, you just aspirate. You just aspirate to see whether in those extreme situations when there are complications, you may have blood or any fecal content coming. So number 2 is aspiration. Number 3 is you just put a saline drop and lift the wall up. Now, if your needle tip is within the peritoneal cavity, the saline drop will be sucked in. Okay? So you know it is inside. Number 4 is you can move the tip of the needle freely. If the tip of the needle is still within the parietal wall, there is going to be restriction in movement of the needle. If the tip is within the peritoneal cavity, you can move the tip. And number five, as you said very correctly, you will attach the insufflator to see whether there is free flow of gas. So when you attach the insufflator, what are the readings that you will anticipate, which will tell you whether or not you are in the peritoneal cavity? Yes.
High pressure system, it indicates that we are in the preperitoneal space.
Right. So if you're in the peritoneal cavity, it is going to be a low pressure with high flow. And if you are in the parietal, the tip of the needle is in the parietis or in the preperitoneal space, it is going to be a high pressure and low flow. Okay. So low pressure, high flow means you are into the peritoneal cavity. Okay. What next?
After creating the neoperitoneum and identifies the first 10 mm trocar into the umbilicus sphere and attach the telescope and under vision, first subsequent ports are made.
So you made the neoperitoneum, initiated the neoperitoneum with a very easy. How do you know that the pneumo is forming? What is the first clinical sign pneumo is forming well?
Obliteration. Look for? Dullness over the
obliteration. Yes. So how much of pneumoperitoneum leads to obliteration of the liver dullness? Around 300 to 400 ml of pneumo will lead to obliteration of the liver dullness. Only after that, you are going to remove the varies and introduce the 10 ml trocar. Okay, fine. So you've introduced the 10 ml trocar. Remember that it is a blind introduction, so you have to be very cautious. And after that, you've attached the insufflator and the pneumo is being formed. How do you do the second port?
Under vision, I will see the second port in the epigastrium. Mm-hmm. Under vision, I will see just to the right of the falciform ligament, directed towards the gallbladder.
Okay, so directed towards the gallbladder and it should be to the right of the falciform.
Right of the falciform.
Okay, what about the other ports?
And third port is made in the mid-clavicular line, just 2 centimeters below the costal margin.
Okay.
And the fourth port is made in the anterior line at the level of the umbilicus, directed towards the gallbladder.
Okay. What is the fourth port for? It is normally for? It's for fundal traction. It is to give the fundal traction. So there are schools of thought where they do not do 4 ports, there are 3 ports. But the classical teaching is that we go for 4 ports. Okay, proceed.
And after with the GP grasper, we will lift the fundus of the gallbladder to the anterior axillary port, and we will give traction towards the patient's right shoulder, so that it will open up the porta hepatis and the infundibulum. With the port in the mid clavicular line, we will retract the infundibulum towards the right inferior and laterally, so it will open up the Calotte's triangle. Now, next is the dissection of the Calotte's triangle.
Okay.
Now, the peritoneum covering the gallbladder and the upper part of the is to be stripped off on both anteriorly and posteriorly, so that we can.
So, which one do you normally do first? Which is recommended
first?
Posterior dissection. The posterior dissection is recommended to be done first. And how far do you dissect?
Until the critical way of safety, we can only the two structures.
The posterior peritoneum that you're dissecting, you go up till how much? The rubeus sulcus. Right? Up to the rubeus sulcus. Okay. Okay. Then what do you do?
In the same way, we will do in the anterior side mark so that the entire calyx will be free from all adhesions and any fibrofatty tissue. And only the two structure till we will do the dissection so that there is no biliary duct in by. To avoid the injuries, we think in a critical way of safety. It means where the only two structures are leaving the gallbladder. And in between two structures, we are able to see the liver also.
Yeah.
And after that, we will do clipping of the cystic duct and cystic artery. And 3 clips in the cystic duct and 2 clips in the cystic artery. And we will divide when the cystic duct and cystic artery. Later, the separation of the gallbladder from the liver surface in the plane. And when we reach the fundus of the time, we will check whether any Calotte is good or not, any bleeding point is there, any bile leak is there. After that, we will remove the gallbladder from the liver surface. And then is the irrigation of the Calotte surface. And we will take out the gallbladder to the umbilical port.
Jyoti, when you remove the gallbladder from the liver surface, what are the things that you are going to look from?
it should be in the plane, that so that it won't lose all our tissue.
You've removed the gallbladder from the liver surface. Now there are certain things that you have to check. So what are the things that you check?
Usually the gallbladder is directly attached to the liver surface without any peritoneum. So there is any bile leak, small cysts of ducts of Lachenkoff will be there. We'll check any bile leak.
So you have
there,
to look for
and
two
there
things.
Is any
you have looked venous, for two things, whether there is any bleeding or not, because inadvertently some sinus bleeding also can occur, and whether there is any biliary leakage from the duct of Lachenkoff or any other accessory ducts which might have opened up when you're separating the gallbladder from the liver bed. Okay, what next?
And when we reach the end of the dissection from the gallbladder and the liver, we will see again once through the callus space, whether any bleeding is there, hemostasis secured or not, and any bile leak is there, clips are okay or not. We'll check once and we'll finally separate the gallbladder from the liver surface, ma'am. And then irrigation.
You are having difficulty in... You have done the calots, but you are trying to do the calots, but there is dense adhesions and you are unable to achieve the critical view of safety, which is so very important. So what are your other options? You are unable to achieve the critical view of safety, which is mandatory when we are doing a lap cholecystectomy. So what are your other options? How else can you
assume background of acute cholecystitis?
Yes. Yes, in a background of acute cholecystitis, the calyx is frozen. So what would you do next?
I'll call for senior help first.
Okay, senior come.
Okay, senior has done. What do you, sir has come. What will sir do then?
What are the options?
Conversion to open.
Conversion open is good one.
Okay, that is always an option.
But Palanivelu and Tatiya does not convert.
Fundus first approach.
Fundus first approach is one. What else?
Okay. What else?
Fundus first approach also has some problems. If you do a fundus first, you keep on going towards the calots, you may injure the CBD because the anatomy is not clear. So fundus first is an option. But what can be the other option? Conversion is one option. Yes, agreed. Second is you find the neck of the gallbladder, okay, and open the neck of the gallbladder. If there is a stone in the Hartmann's pouch, you remove the stone. And then, keeping at the neck of the gallbladder, you are unlikely to injure the bile duct. So, you should do a surgery which is a modification known as subtotal cholecystectomy. So, option is, you can convert to subtotal cholecystectomy. While removing the gallbladder of the bed, you find there is a gush of dark color blood from the bed. What might have gone wrong? There is gush from the bed of the gallbladder bed. What might have gone wrong?
Sinusoid might have opened.
What do you do? How do you tackle that?
First, I'll give pressure and with the gallbladder itself, pulling that. By that time, I might help him. And then I will try to do with this one, ball.
So the pressure is the most important thing. You have to be patient. Just press and hold on. Do not be in a hurry to, buzz it. So after you've attained pressure and then you release and see, you can actually identify the exact bleeding point. And that is when you use your energy source. So don't be in a hurry to diathermize that area right at the beginning.
So you should keep in mind that sinusoidal bleed is very difficult to control with the unipolar cautery.
Yes.
It's very difficult. First is pressure. Most of the time, control the pressure. If not, if you at all use an energy source, you can use a bipolar or a harmonic.
Okay.
Unipolar does not act in sinusoidal bleed. Or at best, you can suture.
Suture it.
Okay, yes. That is the option. Okay. So gallbladder is dissected, free. You have done irrigation. And then you remove the gallbladder. What next?
So if dissection is painful, there is no need of drain. If dissection, I have
style. Should be optional.
Mm-hmm. And closure of foot.
So there is one large stone in the gallbladder and you are having difficulty taking out the gallbladder through the epigastric port. So how do you tackle that?
Madam, we can extend that.
Okay, you can extend the epigastric port. Agreed. Any other option?
We can open the gallbladder and we can take it out the stone.
Yes, and there is always an option of taking out through the umbilical port. You shift your camera to the epigastric port, because the umbilical port is a more stretchable port as compared to the epigastric port. So there is always an option of doing that. And if you are, a lot of surgeons prefer to routinely take out the gallbladder in a bag, but particularly if you're in an acute setting or you are suspecting malignancy, it is always advisable to take out the bag, the gallbladder, and take it out along with the bag to prevent contamination of the port with bile.
We can quickly go to the open system.
Yes.
How do you go about it?
Open colonoscopy.
Yeah.
Yes. After attaining fitness for the surgery, patient in supine position, under general anesthesia when they enter the tube intubation in situ, after proper dressing and draping, right subcostal incision is made, and abdomen is opened in the layers, in the subcutaneous tissue, and the anterector sheath and the external oblique and the first plane, and the rectus abdominis, internal oblique, rectus abdominis on the medial side, internal oblique on the lateral side, and the posterior rectus sheath and the internal transverse abdominis. After that, surgical peritoneum is lifted with the hemostat forceps and it is open. First, we have to explore the abdomen, if there are any liver, any adhesions are there with the duodenum, omentum and colonic, we have to release the adhesions, and then we have to keep the mops to create a proper space for proper.
Where do you position the mops?
One in the hepatic flexion of the colon, one in the lower abdomen to retract the colon and the transverse colon and the duodenum, and one in the medial surface to come for the stomach.
So remove the stomach medially, downwards. Okay.
And then we'll put the retractors. And one on the right lobe of the liver surface and one on the downwards mark. Okay. After attaining the proper space, with the Moynihan's forceps, we will hold the fundus of the gallbladder. And the one more Moynihan's we will keep in the infant one.
So fundus and the?
Infant, Hartmann's.
Hartmann's
one is retracted down and out. So we can open up the chalet's triangle and we will do the dissection. We'll release the peritoneum, we'll strip off the peritoneum on the gallbladder and cystic vein, and we'll dissect the calyps, and cystic artery are separated and then ligated with a suture, a 30 safe material, and we'll cut that one, cut the cystic duct and cystic artery. We'll try to separate the gallbladder, we'll separate the gallbladder from the liver surface.
Okay.
And after separating the fundus, while reaching the fundus, we will see once more with the calyx area.
How do you separate? Only finger or something else also? Along with the finger?
Sir?
How to separate the gallbladder from the bed?
While maintaining the traction on the Moynihan's forceps and the diathermy.
So you use an energy source. Yes.
There is some fringes we need to be coagulated. And you find that a duct-like structure coming in the bed, what do you do? Find there is a duct-like structure in the gallbladder.
That's a flush.
What can this be?
Sir, you are not on.
There might be appearance of a duct-like structure entering into the gallbladder from the liver bed. What this could be?
Ducts of Lascaris.
Yeah.
Ducts of Lascaris. How do you tackle that?
And it will by diathem.
It is better to ligate it with a 305.
Valuma.
Yeah.
So that needs to be ligated.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Any audience question? Anybody from the audience like to say something? Any question? Any query?
I think Dr. Acharya was saying something.
It is mandatory to mention the position of the table and position of the patient.
I think in lab poly, she missed out on that. Yes, yeah, I was realizing that. Yes,
that is one thing. And I think in a difficult pneumoperitoneum, one should always go in for open
port
technique. And yes. she should have some idea about Palmer point also. In a very fat patient, at times it is very difficult to be sure that the varies has gone in. And in those cases, introduction of the varies needle through the Palmer point may be easier.
Right,
Palmer point is a point just below the left costal arch. If you put the needle through this point, it is highly unlikely that any organ will be injured.
Yes, sir.
That is one. And another thing, I think Dr. Professor Emil Saha will also agree with me. When you are doing this this pneumoperitoneum with a varies needle in a PAD patient, when the needle has gone into the falciparum, at times it's very difficult to be sure that it is in the peritoneum, not in the peritoneum and in the varies. In the falciparum ligament, because in those cases, the pressure will tend to be a little in the lower side, but the rate, as Shomita has mentioned very well, the flow rate will be very low, and on percussing the abdomen, there will be no evidence of collection inside the abdomen.
Uniform resonance will not be
right. Uniform.
Yes, that is one. And third point, she mentioned that she will come deliver the gallbladder through the umbilical port. When the stone size is large, a single stone, it may be easier to take it out through the umbilical port, because the vertical incision in the umbilical port can easily be increased, and it would be easier to take it out. But when the stones are multiple small stones, and you are trying to take it out through the umbilical port, and in case the gallbladder ruptures, it's a hell of a job to take out the stones.
The stones get scattered all over the place then.
Yeah, it's not at all possible. So I think in such cases, it's much better to take it out through the epigastric and in a bag.
Yes.
That depends on surgeon practice. Some surgeons prefer still to do only the umbilical port. Some surgeons prefer only to go to the epigastric port. So it's interchangeable. You can use any of the...
Now, I think it would be pragmatic to say that if the stones are multiple small stones, gallbladder wall is a bit friable. If you had to take it out through the umbilical port, you should always take it in a bag.
Yeah, bag. Endobag should be...
Endobag. Right. 9:40. Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you, Jyoti.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you,
sir. Bye.
Meet on Saturday.
Sure.
Seminar on peptic ulcer disease.
Right.
Thank you all.
Okay.
Thank you. Jyoti,
sir.
Case you kept on. Sir. Any case in OT today?
No.